This video deals with the use of the Kerr metric to calculate the proper radius of the ring singularity of a Kerr black hole. It then compares these results with the expected value using the coordinate radius and shows them to be different. This result is due to the difference between coordinates and physical values, since the latter are metrical in nature. All right, so we have a Kerr black hole, the structure. We have the ergosphere within this region here, and the second ergosphere within this region here. We have the outer stationary limit surface, or surface of infinite redshift, in yellow, and then the inner stationary limit surface, or surface of infinite redshift, in blue, the outer event horizon in red, and the inner event horizon in green. And then in the center region here, in the equatorial plane, we have a ring singularity, x squared plus y squared is a squared at z equals zero. All right, the variable a represents the angular momentum per unit of mass. It's angular momentum per unit of mass times c. And the ring singularity here, we have on the ring itself, r equals zero. Outside the ring, r is greater than zero. And within the ring, r is less than zero, r takes on negative values. We've covered that in the closed time-like curves in the playlist on causality. All right, now brief summary. The material here has occurred over the first couple of videos in the Kerr series, so please go back to that. But from the curvature scalar, when the Riemann tensor contracted with itself, shows that only rho equals zero is a real physical singularity. And rho squared is r squared plus a squared cos theta equals zero. That's to be zero, that requires r to be zero, theta to be pi on two, and then that gives us rho equals zero. Taking that back now to our coordinates for the Kerr, remember the Schwarzschild black hole is a spherical one, and the Kerr black hole is a oblate spheroid, so it bulges in the equatorial plane. And the coordinates for those are, from Cartesian to spherical polar, is x equals the square root of r squared plus a squared times sine theta cos phi, y equals square root of r squared plus a squared sine theta sine phi, and z is r cos theta. Now, to satisfy this condition for the singularity, r is zero, so that sends z to zero. Theta is pi on 2, so sine pi on 2 is 1. And what we're left with then is x equals a cos theta, y equals a sine theta, z equals 0. And this describes a circle of radius a in the equatorial plane. So we have a ring singularity of coordinate radius a lying in the equatorial plane. That's z equals 0, the xy plane. Okay, so the coordinate radius here is a units long. A has units of meters, so it's a meters long. But we're going to, in this video, show that that's not the same as the proper distance. So we're going to use in the video the metric here, the Kerr metric, to establish a proper radius here, to determine the distance of the proper radius here. And that'll be the focus of this video. And we'll see that the proper radius and the coordinate radius is given by A, are not the same things. Proper radius has a metrical value, a measurable value, hence metrical, whereas coordinates are not measurements. That's important. Coordinates are not measurements. They're not physical measurement values. We're used to thinking of them like that in Euclidean space, but that's not the case in curved space at all. Right, by using the metric and invariant nature of the magnitude of the fall velocity, we can calculate the proper radius of this ring. In the case of a slowly rotating mass in the weak field approximation, we could imagine a correction to the Schwarzschild. Now, I've been corrected. A viewer of this channel has pointed out I should be saying Schwarzschild. That's a more correct pronunciation for the German name. I agree with that person who's made that comment. I just have to get used to doing Schwarzschild instead of saying Schwarzschild. Anyway, metric to give a new line element, describe this. So what we did, took Schwarzschild, metric and corrected it with a cross term here. Okay, this cross term was added to the Schwarzschild metric to create the new Kerr metric, and you'll see that all in the derivation videos at the beginning of the Kerr series. J is the angular momentum. Now the last term is due to the Lenz theorem effect, which describes a drag of inertial frames, and is valid to first order only in the angular momentum. So J was composed to first order, was set to be equal to the mass times the angular momentum per unit mass times C. Okay, remember A is our coordinate. It came from our oblate spheroid coordinates. So the angular momentum has been approximated to first order with this value here. Okay, now this describes the slowly rotating mass in a weak field approximation. So there are limitations there as well. But A is our coordinate value from the previous slide. Now we can rewrite this using the dimensionless spin parameter A star, A asterisk. Now the angular momentum per unit mass from this expression above is the angular momentum divided by the mass times C. Now dimensionally that's the same as gm on c squared times jc on gm squared, and then we can take out the gm on c squared, factor that out, and we're left with this dimensionless quantity here, which we will call a star. Now in the literature on black holes are often parameterized, expressed according to their mass and this dimensionless spin parameter. And so when we seek out an expression for the proper radius of the ring singularity, we're going to do that in terms of the mass m and the dimensionless spin parameter a star, okay? Because black holes can be parameterized in terms of those two quantities, the Kerr rotating black hole uncharged. All right, so the Kerr space-time line element, Boyer-Lindquist coordinates or space-time interval is this object here. Okay, the Kerr metric is given by this object here. I've written them out in full. I haven't used rho or delta here. Rho squared is r squared plus a squared cos squared theta. I've written out in full. Now we're going to be interested in the region, as I pointed out earlier, in the ring singularity. So we're going to be interested in values, negative values of r that go from minus a to zero. All right, now in this region, a massive particle can remain stationary as a time component. The metric is negative just in this ring singularity region. Outside the ring singularity and up to the stationary, the outer stationary limit surface, that's not the case. Okay, but within the ring singularity itself, it's possible, because the metric component is negative, that a stationary, a particle can remain stationary, not with no change in its spatial components. It can be just traveling in time, but it can remain stationary. So it can have a four velocity in which its spatial components, angular components, are all zero, and it just remains in a fixed location. That's not possible in the other regions within the ergosphere and so on. That's simply not possible, and that's the subject of other videos. But given, and we can show that this is the case, that a particle can remain stationary within this ring singularity region by taking the magnitude squared of the four velocity, u dot u, is the only component of the metric that applies here is the GTT component, because there's no others. That's all negative. Even we're interested in the region R, where R is negative, where R is less than zero, it goes negative here. So negative value here will cancel with this negative here. But overall, the metric term is still negative because of this minus sign here. Okay, so that this altogether, UT times UT times this metric component, can still satisfy minus C squared. Okay, so the square of the magnitude of the four velocity is an invariant quantity all along the world line. It has the same value, whichever the world line, the particle has the magnitude squared of minus C squared, and that is an invariant quantity that we can use to generate a value for the proper distance of the radius of the ring singularity. Remember, just an aside now, I'm just stepping off on a tangent here, but the tangent vector to the world line of a particle has constant magnitude. It's parallel transported along the world line. It's following the straightest possible path in that curved space. Okay, so writing out the four velocity, all of the components, metric terms, fully writing this out for the Kerr rotating black hole, we get this object here. Okay, it's equal to minus c squared. Now, where u mu is the derivative of that particular coordinate with respect to proper time, each of the coordinates with respect to proper time. Theta is pi on 2, so we're in the equatorial plane. The theta as a result is 0, but also we're going to choose a radial path, so we're going to fix phi, so phi is not going to vary, so d phi is 0 as well. Okay, so we can imagine a four velocity of the form this. And when we get magnitude squared of that, we have g mu nu u mu u nu is this object here. Okay, writing out, putting all the terms in, this object here is minus c squared. So we end up with this equation here written all on one line. Here we go. Okay, also just remember here when r is negative, because that's the region of the ring singularity we're interested in inside the ring. This negative and this negative will cancel, but there's still a negative out front here. Okay, now we're going to multiply through by minus one. I want to establish an argument here in this video for calculating the proper radius of this ring singularity. So I'm going to use this, the dr d tau, the r component, and find its proper length. Use it to establish an argument to find the proper length for the radius of this ring singularity. So multiplying through by minus one, we get this object here. Okay, now we can set a condition on the second term, this one here, whereby this is less than c squared. We would expect this first term to be greater than c squared, and then when we subtract this amount here, we'd reasonably expect this to be less than c squared, so that it all sums to c squared. Okay, so when we do that now, we have this object here set less than c squared, and then we're going to square root both sides to give us this object here, dr d tau less than c here, times that square root of that metric component. Now, the part of the term involving the radical symbol, this here, can be, this whole business here can be simplified, but must be ta can be simplified, but can must be taken because the region of r involved is negative. This means the obvious or usual choice here is not the appropriate one. We just have to be, made it messed up the grammar, poorly expressed there, but we need to be careful taking this. Don't just assume the positive r over this object. Don't just assume that, and I'll show you why. We just need to be a little bit careful, and I'll just show you here. So we want to take the square root of this object times dr d tau is less than c. Okay, next page over here. Now, if I take, so here's the original expression here, the square root of this whole thing. This is just a specific example thing. I picked a black hole with 10 to 9 solar masses, so a billion solar mass black hole here. But plotting it's in the negative r region within the ring singularity. Okay, just taking the square root here gives us this object here. So this is a metric in the negative region, goes right down to 0 at r equals 0. Now, if I take the positive square root, it's this object here, I end up with the plot being reflected about the horizontal axis. Now, I can still anti-differentiate, I can still integrate that, but the negative, but the value I will get is the negative value of the signed area. I will get the negative value because it's below the axis. So I can just multiply the answer by minus one there, and that'll still work. But if I just take the negative square root here, then I get this object here, which is again above the horizontal axis and exactly matches this one. So my choice here in this video now will be take the negative square root. Then I will integrate that, and I won't need to multiply the end result by minus one. Okay. I mean, you can use the negative here so long as you remember that you'll end up with a negative distance, dr. Integrated, you'll end up with a negative distance, but you just need to multiply the answer by negative one. So I'm just going to circumvent that right from the beginning and just use this value here. Okay, both are correct. You could use this value. Just remember to multiply your answer at the end by minus one, otherwise you'll have a negative distance. Remember, the area under the curve is the signed value, the integral gives you the signed value of the area under the curve. well, this will give you a negative area here, a negative signed value. So you need to multiply by minus one. Anyway, sorry, I'm just emphasizing that. All right, so we have now minus r on square root of a squared plus r squared minus 2gm r, okay, times dr less than c times d tau. So c times d tau gives us a distance in meters, okay? Don't forget r is less than zero. Yeah, we're within the ring singularity. Now, so this will be less than some maximum value is what I'm getting at here, okay, as I mentioned earlier. And the reason for doing this is this now fractional expression here is now in a simplified form to integrate or to anti-differentiate. Just one more thing we'll do, look at the denominator underneath the radical sign here, and we'll just complete the square on that to produce something a little bit simpler, which then allows us to consult some integral tables. So square root of this object here is this. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to add on a term, which is the 2gm on c squared divided by 2. In parentheses here, we have minus because there's a minus in front. So we add on the square of that, plus our a squared here, and then what we've added on, we have to subtract as well in order to keep it the same. Okay, so we're just completing the square there. When we do that, we can factor this now, and we end up with r minus gm on c squared all squared, plus a squared minus gm on c squared all squared. Okay, and just simplify that down. It's a squared minus gm on c squared all squared. We'll just call that epsilon squared. Then what we can do is we can make a substitution. Let u equals r minus gm on c squared, du becomes dr, and we can also rearrange that for r equals u plus gm on c squared. So we're going to put this whole expression here in a simpler form and then consult some integral tables. Substituting these terms gives us this object here is u plus gm on c squared, square root of all that, okay? And then writing that out, u on this object here plus gm on c squared times that, call this u. So we've simplified it right down. We've got u on the square root of u squared plus epsilon squared plus gm on c squared times 1 on the square root of u squared plus epsilon squared. Okay, now the integral tables come into it, right? First one, the integral of u on the square root of u squared plus or minus epsilon squared dx is just the square root of u squared plus or minus epsilon squared. You can see that by inspection, because if I just differentiate this now, I'll get 1 over 2 times the square root of everything there, times then the derivative of u squared, which is 2u. The 2s will cancel out. I'm left with just u over that. So this can be done by inspection. This one here is a little bit more complicated from the integral tables. 1 on square root of u squared plus or minus epsilon squared dx gives you a log, natural log of the absolute value of u plus square root of u squared plus or minus epsilon squared. That comes from the arc shine. If you want to go through and integrate it, which I don't need to do in this video, but you'd use inverse shine for that, arc shine, and then evaluate it between some terminals. All right, next one. So an antiderivative can be found for this. So don't forget the minus here, because remember we had minus r on the square root of this, and that means we have a minus here and a minus there, putting our expressions in. Anti-differentiating this. Well, remember this object here from the integral table was just a square root of u squared plus epsilon squared minus gm on c squared times the natural log of u plus the square root of u squared plus epsilon squared. Okay, writing these out. Okay, one more thing we can do that here is I'll put the epsilon squared back in. So epsilon squared was a squared minus gm on c squared all squared. Hence the expression gets a bit longer. Okay, and then we just tidy that up a little bit. And we end up with this object here. Okay, if I expand all that out, okay, I'll end up with this object here again. Remember how we completed the square on this to produce this, okay? Well, if I expand it all out, I end up with that. Same here, expand that, I end up with that. So that looks a little bit simpler. All right, next one. Now to evaluate over the region of interest. So now we want to find the proper distance. We want an expression for that. So we're going to integrate in the positive direction from minus a up to zero, okay, of this object here. So that's just evaluating our antiderivative from the previous slide between minus a and zero. That's this object here, substituting the zero and the a in. Now, r is zero, all that drops out, that's zero, plus a squared, that's zero there. So we just get the square root of a squared, which is a, plus then gm, r is zero, that drops out, r is zero, square root of a here. So they go here, oh, hang on, sorry. Yeah, no, zero goes in there, yep. Zero disappears, that's a, and we get natural log a minus gm on c squared. Have I got anything else there? No, that's it, and then the second one here. So here's our expression evaluated here, putting the a in. Now what we're going to do is, the next step now is we're going to replace the a in terms of a quantity involving the dimensionless spin parameter, because although we found here the proper distance here in terms of a, what's quoted in the literature tends to be the mass of the black hole and the dimensionless spin parameter. So we can express a spin parameter in terms of the mass m and the dimensionless spin parameter a. So the spin parameter a in terms of the dimensionless spin parameter a star and the mass. So any black hole can be described by its mass and its angular momentum, where the latter is defined using this dimensionless parameter. So a star, if you remember, was jc on gm squared. So the relationship between the coordinate radius a is equal to gm on c squared times the dimensionless spin parameter a star. All right, so doing all that now, we're replacing the a with the gm on c squared a star, gives us quite a long expression, which there has to be tidied up. And as we do that, we get some common factors which can come out, as in we end up here. We had the, we can take out gm on c squared times a star minus one, for instance, in here. Here we've got gm on c squared times a star all squared. So we end up here with, if we come down here, we can take out the gm on c squared all squared, that gets factored outside the radical sign, outside, okay, here radical, and we're left with inside two times a star squared plus a star. Okay, that happens also down here as well. Following on, we can now use the log laws, and we get the natural log of gm on c squared times the natural log of this object, okay, which is what we have down here. And then what happened was that this plus log of gm on c squared cancel this minus log of gm on c squared here. And we're left with a star, we're left with a square root here, and we're left with this log of a star minus one. Okay, so a little bit of cancelling has occurred there and some simplification. And we can also, all of these terms have a gm on c squared out front, so that just comes right out front altogether. The expression is getting simpler. Now we're going to apply the log laws again, and we're going to break up a few things. We just go over the page. We end up over here, gm on c squared, we have this object here plus this minus that. And what we can do here is that log of this minus log of this can be expressed as this object here. Then we only have the a star, this a star here, and this square root 2a star times a star plus 1 in brackets, okay, collected together there. So it's got a lot simpler now. Okay, so the proper distance from the center of the ring to the edge is this object here. All right. Now, so let's, instead of having to quote the this expression on the left here, I might just call that D subscript proper. So the proper distance from the center of the ring out to the edge in a straight line is D proper is gm on c squared times this object. Okay, so we've now giving the proper distance in terms of the mass of the black hole and its dimensionless spin parameter. All right, let's look at some examples now in the rest of this video. So Sagittarius A star, the black hole at the center of our galaxy, has a mass of 4.2 million solar masses and a dimensional spin parameter A star of 0.44, plus or minus that error there. Okay, so substituting A star and M in here, okay, what we end up with is a proper distance of 6.6933 times 10 to the 8 meters. Now compare this with the coordinate value, and the coordinate value A is gm on c squared times A star. Doing that, we get 2.7241 times 10 to the 9 meters. So there's a difference here of, it's going to be less than a factor of 10, but you can see from 10 to the 8 to 10 to the 9, you can see there's a difference here. So remember, d proper is the proper distance. It is the metrically derived distance. It will be consistent with a measured value, should that be possible at some stage. Whereas this is a coordinate value. Now, coordinates and metrical quantities are two separate things. Metrical meaning measured. Okay, so proper distance, measured distance, is different to its coordinate value. And what we find then is spin parameter is larger. That's the value of A, sorry, is larger than the proper distance by a factor of. So the spin parameter, the angular momentum per unit mass, A, is 4.0699 times the proper distance. So it's out by a factor. So the proper distance is shorter by a factor of 1 on 4, or the coordinate value is greater than the proper distance by a factor of 4. Now, the supermassive black hole at the heart of the quasar Q2237 plus 305, the mass of 10 to the 9 billion solar masses and a dimensional spin parameter A star of 0.74, according to these researchers here, quoted in that paper there. And its proper distance using these values then is 3.1138 times 10 to the 11 meters, whereas its coordinate value is 1.0908 times 10 to the 12 meters. Now its proper distance, now its coordinate values, coordinate distance, its coordinate value is 3.5, 3.5 times greater than its proper value. There's a difference there. Cygnus X1 has a mass of 21.2 plus or minus 2.2 solar masses and a dimensional spin parameter greater than 0.9985, according to Miller Jones and others. And so its proper distance using these values is 9,571.6611 meters, and its coordinate value is 31,203.4086 meters. And so its coordinate value is 3.6 times greater than its proper radius. So its coordinate radius is 3.62 times its proper radius. Now, the nearest black hole to us at a distance of 1.06 plus or minus 0.12 kiloparsecs, according to Cantrell and Sullivan, is named A0620-00, and it has a mass of 6.61 solar masses and a dimensional spin parameter of 0.12, according to these researchers. And its proper radius, substituting those values in, is 175.6929 meters, whereas its coordinate radius is 1169.2323, and so its coordinate radius is 6.655 times its proper distance. So it makes you wonder, this is quite noticeably larger than the other values, this factor here. Maybe the spin parameter is out, maybe the mass is out. This, anyway, this value by about, it differs from the others on average by about a factor of 2. So anyway, the microquasar GRS 1915 plus 105 contains a 12.4 solar mass black hole with a dimensional spin parameter A star 0.98, according to Reed and others. And so using those values, we have a proper radius of 5,471.8844 meters and a coordinate radius of 17,912.8986 meters. And so its coordinate radius is 3.2736 times its proper radius. Now, these calculations point clearly to the difference between the coordinate radius and the proper radius. Now, coordinate values are not physical measurements. Coordinate values are used to calculate with, they are not the same as physical measurements. Metrical quantities, such as derived from the metric, agree with measurement. Okay, coordinate values do not. So, this is just another example of that fact.